In our last episode, Mexico had lost half of its territory after the American invasion, including California, New Mexico, Arizona, Utah, Nevada, Texas, Wyoming, Colorado, and part of Kansas. Santana's dictatorship had radicalized the political positions, even though both parties, the conservatives and the liberals, aspired to progress, their ideas to achieve it were very different. The conservatives insisted on a monarchy and a corporate society. The liberals considered that a representative republic, federal and popular, similar to the North American model, could guarantee it, and consider urgent to erase all colonial heritage, confiscating all the clergy's properties. Still, even the liberals, divided among themselves, had different ideas of how to achieve it. In 1855, the liberals occupied the capital and elected a provisional president, Juan Alvarez, who formed a cabinet with Benito Juarez among the participants, the pure liberals. However, Alvarez resigned the presidency and Comonfort took his place. Comonfort changed the cabinet to moderate liberals. He promulgated two reform laws. First, he disentailed rustic and urban properties belonging to civil and religious corporations. And second, he banned the fixed fees that the poor had to give to the church. The archbishop immediately repudiated the decrees, considered them an attack on the church. Many more controversial topics were debated, such as education and tolerance of cults, to eliminate the Catholic religion as the state's religion, finally not prohibiting any cult. The Constitution of February 1857 was not radical and introduced the rights of men, liberty of education and work, freedom of expression and property, and the guarantee of not being detained for more than 3 days without justification. The president had no economic resources. Not even all the ecclesiastic properties could solve the problem, and he had more difficulties. The conservatives were unhappy with the reforms, and the pure liberals thought the reforms were insufficient. Benito Juarez took advantage of the wavering attitude of many of the politicians. He had firm constitutional convictions. He belonged to a monolingual ethnia from the Oaxacan mountain range, educated in the Science Institute seminar of his state. Radical federalists as well as centralists had supported his career. He was elected deputy of the Congress in 1847 and became governor of his state. He finally was elected as president of the Supreme Court of Justice. When this happened, he returned to the capital. Félix Zuloaga, a conservative, gave a coup d'etat and declared himself president. The existence of two presidents, Zuloaga and Comonfort, inevitably took the country to civil war, which lasted 3 years. Still, the foreign representatives recognized Zuloaga as president. Benito Juarez fled to Veracruz, a liberal state, because it could also give him revenue from the customs. Miramón took Zuloaga's presidency and went to Veracruz and attacked by sea and land. He besieged the port but failed because the United States withdrew their support to the conservatives and supported Juarez. He and his cabinet issued more reform laws. They nationalized the clergy properties, separated church from state, suppressed religious orders, secularized cemeteries, and freedom of worship. Both groups had no economic resources and took them to compromise the country with foreign agreements. Washington accepted to support the liberals to get more territory from Mexico, which was not accepted. However, they signed the treaty McLean-Ocampo, which in exchange for $2 million, they would have free transit through the Isthmus of Tehuantepec. But the American Senate disapproved. The conservatives went to Europe and made several dealings that gave them discredit abroad. After the failure of the conservatives, they were jilted and increased their conspiracies in Europe and recurred to murder, killing several important liberal figures. Elections gave Juarez the presidency, and he immediately reorganized the administration, education, and adopted the metric system. The lack of resources made him stop payments on the usurious interest of loans from Britain, Spain, and France. This gave the Mexican monarchists in Europe the opportunity to interest Napoleon III to install a monarchy in Mexico, who had the dream of having a Latin empire that would help him to have a retaining wall against the Anglo-Saxon expansion. So the suspension of payments was the opportunity to intervene. He summoned Great Britain and Spain to discuss the matter, and on October 31, 1861, the three countries signed a treaty to block the Mexican ports in the Gulf of Mexico to force payments. The Spanish fleet arrived in Veracruz in December, and in January, the French and the English fleets arrived. Juarez received an ultimatum and sent Minister Manuel Doblado to negotiate with the interventionists. He assured them that Mexico would pay as soon as possible. The British and the Spanish accepted and left, but the French did not, so they disembarked. April 17th, the French advanced into Mexico. In such a critical situation, Juarez authorized the formation of guerrillas. Ignacio Zaragoza was ready to defend Puebla against the best army in the world. Count Lorenzon, trusting in his complete superiority, he dismissed warnings, and on May 5th, Zaragoza's chiefs defeated him. Humiliation only made Napoleon send 30,000 more soldiers under a new commander. A year later, Mexican troops concentrated in Puebla without General Zaragoza, who had died of typhus. After the besiege, the city succumbed. Juarez fled, and the town was occupied by the French. The French proclaimed the empire on July 19th and announced that France was inviting Maximilian of Habsburg to occupy the Mexican throne. They installed a regency in the meantime Maximilian arrived. Maximilian was brother to the Austrian emperor, and his wife was Carlota Amalia, daughter of the King of Belgium. He signed treaties with Napoleon III, who assured him that Mexico would pay the adventure's cost. France would keep 28,000 soldiers in Mexico and give him a loan of 175 million francs, of which Maximilian would only receive 8. The rest France would hold to pay the debt to France and the cost of wars plus interest. The secret treaty points out that France would send more soldiers until the army would be of 38,000 soldiers. Before leaving, Maximilian's brother, Francis Joseph of Austria, forced Maximilian to sign a family pact to renounce all rights to the Austrian throne. After a short visit to the Pope, they embarked to Mexico. Maximilian and Carlota arrived in Veracruz at the end of May 1864. Nobody received them at the port, in contrast with the reception received with the elite society of Orizaba, Puebla, and Mexico when they arrived in Mexico City. Many moderate liberals collaborated with the imperial government, hopeful that they would solve the country's problems afflicting the country since 1821. Maximilian was a convinced liberal, and he confirmed he would not suppress cult tolerance. Neither would he cancel the nationalization of clergy assets, as the Pope had demanded. This decision deprived him of the support of many conservatives. The city was embellished and charged with new life with the imperial court. The government installed gas lighting and planted ash trees. The Imperial Avenue was built, which later was named by the liberals as the Paseo de la Reforma, most important avenue in the city nowadays. The emperor started writing laws for the empire. He wrote a civil code and agrarian laws that would return properties to the original owners, the natives, and gave properties to those who did not have any. He established a working shift no longer than 10 hours and annulled debts and banned physical punishment. The emperor also considered economic development. The empress promoted female education. Maximilian divided the country into 50 departments, started building the national railroad between Mexico and Veracruz, and authorized the Bank of London, Mexico, and South America to facilitate commercial exchange. The French occupation forced Juarez to go to the north and stayed there until the United States Civil War ended. The liberals were able to get a loan of 3 million pesos from the United States, who gave support to Benito Juarez, and also protested against the French invasion. The empire had no more money from the French loan, and Napoleon withdrew his troops because he needed all the soldiers due to the German Confederation's consolidation. Francis Joseph offered to send him 4,000 soldiers. Still, the protest of the United States against the invasion stopped him from doing so. Carlota offered to go to Europe to get some aid, but neither the Pope nor Napoleon agreed to see her. In desperation, she went back to Belgium, and she lost her mind and never returned to Mexico. The news convinced Maximilian to surrender, but his minister's opposition made him desist. Meanwhile, the Mexican liberal army won several battles against the French, and Maximilian, Miramón, and Mejía fled to Querétaro. Treason facilitated their apprehension. A martial court tried them and condemned them to the maximum penalty. Despite receiving petitions for clemency from all the world to spare the Habsburgs' life, Juarez did not cede. Maximilian accepted his faith, and after writing to his mother and his wife, he faced the platoon with great dignity. The French intervention was far from bringing stability to the country that the conservatives thought it would get. They encouraged the intervention, caused useless bloodshed, and total bankruptcy to the country. Juarez was inflexible in his decision because he said, "Mexico will never again accept a foreign invasion and an empire. Let this be an example to the world. Mexico is a free country." Loving Mexico thanks you for being with us today. Be sure to subscribe and leave a comment. continue watching our videos and enjoy loving Mexico.